I think we should get the blowback out of the way first, and why it was really hurtful for Russell to be on that platform, first off, for Russell to be on Tidal, and also the way that you responded to him being slid into the show, according to your tweets, 2.5 hours into the broadcast, unbeknownst to you. I think that would be a good place to start, because as I read your tweets, I understand when people are caught off guard, particularly when you're dealing in a professional situation, it can be extremely disorienting. But I see you as somebody who, look, I've seen you on TV. We've done an interview together. You're quick on your feet. And so the fact that you didn't, in that moment, either disengage as an act of protest, or even call out the elephant in the room, which is, all right, we're talking about Black Lives Matters. Russell, you're on here. Let's talk about Black women's lives and how they matter, and why you're sitting in Bali right now in a country without extradition treaty, sliding into this conversation.
Let me say to you publicly what I said to you privately, which is that I'm deeply sorry. I apologize. I know that as someone who has been harmed, to it can be re-triggering. It can be more harm to you to see him or other people, but also to see people who you identify as allies to be in those spaces not doing the correct and principled thing. And so that's my accountability. That's my mistake. And again, I'm deeply, deeply sorry to you. And of course, I called you and I called some of the other people, everyone I know who has discussed Russell Simmons and all of the allegations that I know far too well, and talk to them about it as well. But again, I think it's important to say it publicly that I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I appreciate the apology. You know, it's not just for me. I mean, granted, I was the one out the gate yelling about it, which is kind of my thing. But, you know, this is for all the survivors, all of his survivors, but also all survivors in general. The ones who will see that interview, or who saw it being promoted and then saw your response and even your initial tweets explaining how things went down, and say, you know what, that's why it's not safe for us to speak. Because even the quote good guys aren't willing to stand up for us when we need them. And I think this is a teachable moment for men who are not abusers to really understand the important role that they play in ending systemic sexual violence against women, particularly in this instance, I'm talking about Black women who have been harmed by Russell, but also those whose perpetrators have never been named.
Yeah. No, I think that's right. I think that one of the things I was thinking about yesterday, so there were a few things I was thinking. One was, in the moment, because I froze. Like I saw him, and I was stunned. And you know, I remember calling Talib Kweli the next day, and before, like, we talked, and we both had the same reaction, which was, "Yo, I can't believe that shit just happened." Like, you looked the way I felt. You know, we were both sort of surprised by it. My response, though, specifically, was to figure out how I could get out of the situation, right? That was a moment to do more than get out of the situation. I felt a certain, I felt discomfort, and I knew that doing something with Russell was the wrong thing to do, so I didn't want to be a part of it. And so I'm like, I need to get out of here. I was thinking about my own discomfort a lot, and that's what I was tweeting. Mm-hmm. Today. And I was also thinking about, of course, that it just, it looks crazy, right? I can't take that part away either. You know, I certainly think it's a good look. I knew why it would not be, particularly for someone who has my politics and who expresses these values. So, you know, in that moment, I had the option of just walking away and not caring about whether or not the producer said go, right? Not mm-hmm. waiting for Nori to text me back. I could have just left. Or I could have said, even if they cut it out later, I could have said, I can't stay on the show and here's why. Or I could say, Russell, what about X, Y, and Z? As someone who, you know, has very close connections to sexual violence, you know, family, other experiences, etc., there's a part that freezes because it's like, yo, this is really heavy. But the heaviest part wasn't that. I'd be dishonest to say that that's what it was. The heaviest part was that I had a certain, there's a certain level of privilege that comes with being able to say, I'm just going to wait for this to end and then tell the producer to delete it, you know? And that mm-hmm. becomes more about me than about the issue. That becomes more about me than it does about everyone who's been harmed. And for me, it's not an abstract thing. I have friends who have been harmed. You know, I have friends who have said, you know, Russell has done this to me. I have friends who are in therapy in response to what they're saying Russell has done. And I'm not using this language because I don't believe them. I'm using this language because we legally have to. Mm-hmm. I just want to be clear for anyone watching that I believe them 100%. I have absolutely no doubt that these women are telling the truth. And so for me to be in that proximity and in that awkward a setting was challenging, and I fell short. It's easy to say, no, I won't jump on a show with him, right? That's the easy part. The hard part is when you're confronted in the moment and you have to be courageous and you have to do the principal thing on behalf of someone else. And the last thing I want to say was just about that was just, I think what I had said to myself this morning is if a white supremacist had walked on the show, if someone who had shot, if a police officer who had shot someone, an unarmed black person had come on the show, I wouldn't have needed to wait for a producer to bounce or to say, the fuck are you doing, right? Mm-hmm. I would have been very comfortable disregarding all professional rules, disregarding any discomfort, not worrying about the blowback from the host. I would have done the right thing. And so mm-hmm. what I've been trying to be self-critical about is why does this get a lower level of attention or commitment or passion when every part of me knows that every part of me is committed to this politically, but the gap between what I'm believing and how I try to navigate through the world and what I did in that moment where it really matters, just like the locker room moments, just like the, you know, all those mm-hmm. moments, like that's your character. That's who and where you are. And that's why I felt ashamed on some level, but also like deeply, like trying to be deeply self-aware and self-critical about it to figure out how I can not do that. And I don't want to make this about me. I don't want to center myself in this. This isn't like one of those red table talk things where I get redeemed. I don't want that. Like, this is not about centering me, but I just needed to be clear that I do understand why what I did was problematic. And how even my apology yesterday probably, no, definitely was not enough to acknowledge the harm that's caused by me even being in that space and not saying and doing the right thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I appreciate you not making this about you, because right now you, because of your political ideologies, because of your privilege, because of who you are versus everyone else that was on that show, had, as well as being the moderator, you know, had more control, perceptually more control. Yeah. And I think, you know, the last part that I want to just say about that is, you know, I was wondering as I was thinking through things, you know, there was an opportunity when that whole incident occurred for you to just tweet about it, to share and say, hey, I did this interview this just happened and I'm not down for it and you all need to know. And so the by asking them to cut him out, it's a prophylactic that doesn't address the real issue of not stepping up then and speaking out, and then the way that things were handled yesterday as well, it being a reactive response. And I'm not trying to take a cudgel to you, because I think at a certain point there, we got to move on and talk about the reasons, the contributing factors in the way in which we're socialized that would lead someone like yourself to take the actions that you took. And you mentioned about what your response would have been if a white supremacist had come on, or a cop who killed a black person. You would have bounced. You would have cut it immediately. And I think,
or said something.
Yeah, or said something. And I think that's a good analogy, because black men far too often see the struggle of black women as being distant, because it's not embodied in them and they're bearing witness to what is happening to us. It may feel one degree different. I'm not saying for all men. I'm just saying for a lot of men that I've spoken to, especially seeing the responses that I've gotten, by and large, it's women who are speaking up and speaking out and that are leading the charge against this rehabilitation campaign that is being facilitated by different media outlets who are tight with Russell. I mean, that's just the only way I can think about it. He did not just slide in on a Zoom session without it being co-signed by multiple people. It just didn't happen. And so when we're talking about this, when we're talking about this issue, you know, it goes to the privilege that black men have as a result of their gender, and why they can opt out of looking at the issues that harm women.
Yeah.
But they will never opt out of addressing the issues that are a result of their blackness. And that is privilege. And I've had plenty of black men pop in my mentions saying that the black man is the most persecuted human being in the world, and you're distracting from the movement for black lives. We have bigger fish to fry. Who cares? You're still alive. And just complete erasure and minimization of the pain and the burden that black women carry, of the fact that, one, it's not even acknowledged how much we suffer at the hands of police. And we also are subject to police brutality, and the uptick in our incarceration rates are through the roof. The over-policing of young girls is young black girls, but also the burden of the sexual violence that the police inflict upon us that no one talks about. The second most reported complaint against cops is sexual violence, sexual assault. But we're not allowed to talk about that, because if we do that, then somehow we're betraying black men.
But you said something else that really struck me, and that was the question of embodiment. because there's a group of us who would agree with everything you said, right? We go to the rallies, we write the books, we quote the statistics, we do this other stuff. But then there are moments, whether it's with me on Drink Champs or whether it's that everyday talk, whether it's other stuff, where we know the stuff and we may even believe the stuff, but when something's at stake, when something is real at stake, you know what I mean? Social discomfort, a job, a relationship, like a social relationship, a networking connection, suddenly we can convince ourselves of how and why that thing that we would do in any other circumstance isn't worth doing in this moment. And mm-hmm. so there's the people who just don't see Black women as people and therefore don't see any kind of pain or suffering as legitimate. And then there's of us who intellectually can see it, but then there are these moments, and it's not every moment, of course, but there are these moments where we fall short. And I think the answer to both of those is I think they're both symptoms of the same problem. You know, I don't think that one group is better than the other, although one is might be more further along the way. I think at the core, like to your point, we haven't embodied this idea of really appreciating and understanding women's humanity, whether it's women, girls, femmes. We haven't fully embodied that. We haven't fully taken that in and understood it properly. And I think that's where we fall short. And that's how, in the case of Russell, or Me Too in hip hop, you know, that's how more broadly, right, this conversation we were having. I think that's how people like Russell can live in hip hop for decades, right? And rest on the legend status as opposed to being accountable for the harm that's been done.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, an interesting defense that I see deployed until a story hits critical mass, as in the case of R. Kelly. I don't see too many people repping for the Pied Piper, right? I don't.
Not now.
But it took decades of activism, journalism, and campaigning for him to even begin to be held accountable. And part of that, I believe, is tied into his diminished earning capacity, yeah, and the fact that he is an artist. And Russell is the godfather of hip hop because of him and Rick Rubin. But, you know, coming out with Def Jam, he put food on the table for many, many, many people. If you work in media, in entertainment, even in academia, it doesn't matter. Russell is ubiquitous.
Yeah.
Certain level, if you're in the philanthropic field, you were going to his Art for Life. You knew about his Art for Life events. If you were in music, everybody was connected to him by one degree of separation. At least anybody who is capable of doing anything to put a person on. And the silence that you see and the complicity that's happening is because so many people feel a sense of allegiance to him because they would not have the privilege that they have, which really is economic privilege,
yeah,
as well as in some cases with artists that he has admittedly ripped off in the past. If they don't have economic privilege, that they have a legacy. And so people have this very corrupted sense of loyalty that is based upon finance. And it doesn't, finance, and also, let's be real, people love celebrities.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, when, yeah, one of the, Mike Tyson was convicted of rape, he went away, he came out, and Desiree Washington is still nowhere to be found. And he gets to get cameos in movies, a Broadway show, documentaries, all this is done. And none of it addresses the fact that he is a rapist.
Yeah.
That can be said. That's not alleged. He was convicted. And when Black men say allegations which haven't been proven, these are allegations. Russell is being tried in the court of public opinion, and this isn't fair to him. And he even said, oh, I've lost $30 million as a result of this whole Me Too thing. I mean, I'm paraphrasing.
Yeah.
He was on the Breakfast Club. I'm like, why is it that Black people, and I'm saying these are people of all genders, because I see people of all genders defending him and others who are accused of violence against women and saying, well, where are the charges? He was never convicted. But we don't wait for the convictions of cops before we rally behind the lives of those who are victims of extrajudicial police violence and murder. It's a given, because we know the system is corrupt.
Right.
We know that's how it's stacked. Well, guess what? The system is stacked against Black women in multiple ways because of our gender. And anyone who's done any research knows that there is an global epidemic of sexual violence that occurs against women and girls, irrespective of their race or ethnicity. But in our case, because of the complications around the history in this country of our oppression and living in a white supremacist society that has weaponized rape allegations against Black men as a way to justify their lynchings, now Black women are not allowed to advocate for ourselves nor do the work to help protect others in the community from becoming victims of the same person.
Right.
And we shouldn't just be rallying for those who are victimized by the police and believing those who say that they're victimized by the police. We need to believe survivors when they speak out and say that they were violated, that they were raped, because it is extensive. It's an extensive problem in our society. And yet, what our racial solidarity, which has enabled us to move forward, and let's be very clear, Black women have been on the front lines leading social movements for centuries, but we don't get the credit. There's a man at the front, the women do the work, the man gets the credit. And this is not a bash Black man session. This is just stating things as they are in this heteropatriarchal society. Bottom line is, our gender is weaponized against us when it's convenient by those that we love and will protect the most. We will put our own lives at risk to ensure that Black men don't become additional victims of the carceral regime. But we should not be put in that position where we have to be unsafe or we are punished because we dare speak out, nor be labeled as race traitors because we're speaking the truth.
You said something that I thought was super interesting. You know, when you said we advocate for Black men, whether or not they get a guilty verdict. whether or not there's a charge from the police. I mean, so I don't need the police. I don't need Darren Wilson to get indicted for me to say Michael Brown was wrongfully killed and to investigate, right? But I also think that, again, it's a dishonest argument because we also don't have that much faith in the state anyway, right? Mm-hmm. It's not like that's the actual issue. I know you're getting at that. We don't want any more information, right? It's not like we say, well, you know, there's no charges, but let's investigate this thing, which is what we do with Mike Brown, the Mike Browns of the world, right? We just buried Rayshard Brooks, right? There's all sorts of gray in that case in the minds of someone who wants to defend the police, right? Again, you should not be killed for running away, but someone who's pro-police would say, well, he was running away, he grabbed the taser, right? There's gray. Black people are like, nope, he shouldn't die, no matter what he did. And they're right. But when it comes to sexual violence, we're like, what was she wearing? What time did she get there? Suddenly, anything becomes a gray and anything becomes an excuse for context. The fact that a cop has 11 complaints against him or 10 complaints against him, we say, well, that's evidence that he engages in police brutality. Of course, a cop will say, well, you know, everybody complains about us. You know, you can't believe what everybody says. And we say, no, that's ridiculous. If there's smoke there, there's fire. But someone could have 50 sexual assault allegations against them from different people. And we're like, yeah, but nothing's been proven yet. It's a willful ignorance. It's a willful, with the commitment to not believing women. It's not just it's not a legal issue. It's not a different evidence issue. It's we're looking for reasons to not have to be accountable for this stuff. And I think part of it is because to hold a Bill Cosby accountable or an R. Kelly accountable or a Russell Simmons accountable is also for us to then have to be reflective about our own lives, our own practices, all the harm we may have done, right? And there are people who say, and I've heard people say this, well, shit, if what he did was rape, then ... right? And they start to think about their own stuff. And I think that's part of it as well, is like, how do you, you know, there's a lot at stake for people who are willfully ignorant about this stuff or stubborn about this stuff. And that goes to this point about rape culture. It's not enough to just say, well, he says he didn't do it. And it's not enough for him to be sincere. We have to look at the actual practices that we're engaging in as a community and find out the ways that they are causing harm, the ways that they constitute rape or sexual assault or all these other terms that some are legal, some are socially constructed, but agreed upon. But we have to sort through that stuff and figure out the harm that's being done and not let the law, not allow the law to let us off the hook.
Well, the law is invoked by Black men when it's convenient, specifically around this issue.
Yeah.
Black men have no faith in the system except when it comes to the allegations.
Rape exonerations, yeah.
Okay, so, and domestic violence. Anything that has to do with violence against women. I wrote about the rape in my 2007 book that was published. I wrote about it again in my book that was published in 2016. I've spoken on college campuses about it at Take Back the Night events, never saying his name. And in my story, there's no question that what happened to me was not consensual, because a couple things happen, and this is where people get, you know, they like to muddy the waters. Russell and I had a conversation earlier in the day around 4 p.m. where I told him that I had a boyfriend, I was happy, and it wasn't that kind of a party. And he told me that he respected that. And he also said, grabbing my hands, that we would be friends forever. And that he would respect my right to bodily autonomy. That's not his words, but that's what happened.
Yeah.
He wasn't drinking that day. I was drinking. Come November, God willing, I'll have 26 years sober. But at that time, I drank a lot. And we went out that night to different parties. And I've had people criticize me when I say, oh yeah, Russell and I partied hard. And then they bring up his self-admitted drug problem and they think, oh, so she's a drug addict. I'm like, okay, first off, alcohol is a drug. Let's be clear. It's legal, but it doesn't matter. He was sober that night. He was sober. And even if I had been high as a kite on any drug, I cannot consent.
Right. Especially if you're high as a kite.
Exactly. And what happened was that I was drunk to the point where I was fading in and out of consciousness. It's kind of like that gray area where you know what's happening, but you just can't effectively do much of anything because you just want to pass out. You just want to sleep. And that's when the rape occurred. And that's something that he has never addressed, is that what happened between us, by definition, is considered rape. Now, one of the differences is our society has changed and is waking up to the vast, the different definitions of what sexual coercion, sexual assault, and rape are. A lot of times, going back in the day, a lot of people think about what happened on college while they're in college. Oh, well, I was with this person, you know, I said no to him, but he just kept on going and I just let him do it because I got tired of just wrestling around with him. And how many times has that happened? How many times has a man heard, no, I really want to just stop here. Oh, come on, baby. You know, don't do this to me. Don't do this. And then finally, you know, the person submits.
Yeah.
That's rape.
Absolutely.
That's sexual coercion and that's rape.
Yeah. And
I've had people, you know, I had a good friend of mine tell me, well, I think one of the reasons why your assault really doesn't resonate with people is because it wasn't really violent. It's not like a gun was held to your head. And this is by a good friend. This is by someone who is woke. And it broke my heart to hear him say this, but I was also grateful that he spoke his truth, because then we were able to have a real conversation about his own past behavior. And that's where we trace the through line to why he could feel comfortable to say something like that, because he ended up saying, look, if getting a woman drunk in order to take advantage of her is rape, well, then I'm a rapist. And I said, well, you are. And people don't want to have these hard conversations. And I,
no, they don't.
Conversations that are scary. People are afraid of the implications of what an admission of their own behavior, past behavior, would have on their life today. Okay, I did that in college, but I shouldn't be held accountable for what happened 25 years ago. But guess what? The victim of these actions has to live with this for the rest of their lives. And your comfort should not come before that of the person that you victimize.
I saw on the record the film about the Russell Simmons survivors. I saw an earlier cut, but I saw it, I want to say in January. And I want to hear your take on that journey to get this made and what the struggles are. I watched it and was overwhelmed and shaken by it, honestly. Again, I knew several of the women in the film, and understood their experiences long before there was a film. Mm-hmm. And I know women who have never come forward who have made similar claims, almost identical. It's almost eerie how identical mm-hmm. some of my friends' claims are who have never come forward. And yet this film has had sort of a battle or a struggle to come out. Why?
Media, the teams, there are like four teams working simultaneously to get press out there. And if you name any major publication, it has covered the film. What is missing is if you go on to Instagram, for example, and put in the hashtag Russell Simmons, there's nothing about the film. The first time that anything comes up about the film on a site with, on an account with a substantial following was when I went on The Breakfast Club and also when Russell went on The Breakfast Club. That's it. And that was kind of the moment where you could pierce that veil, because I've said it before, I'll say it again. He's got these celebrity-driven sites on lock. That's a whole different conversation, is how that ecosystem works. Yeah. But Black people haven't heard about it, because a lot of us are not getting our news through The Hollywood Reporter or Variety or The New York Times or The Washington Post.
Yeah.
If people are looking at the New York Post, or if they're looking at Rolling Out or The Shade Room or, you know, whatever, like, you're not going to see the film. And there's a reason.
It's not a coincidence, right?
And so this situation has been a gift and a curse. And when I say situation, I'm talking about Russell's repeated attempts in the last 2 weeks to leverage large media platforms in order to reinsert himself into the dialogue about Black lives and social justice with zero accountability from his nice place in Bali, that he is actually pulling strings to make sure that people don't watch the film. And that is something that points to what brought us here in the first place, which was how media can be complicit in silencing the stories of survivors. This film doesn't have a movement behind it like Surviving R. Kelly had with the Mute R. Kelly campaign, which had been going on for years beforehand. This film is really one of those top-down documentaries where there's not a wellspring of grassroots support to help drive people to see it.
Which is crazy, because you would think that it wouldn't need it. I mean, and you would think that the groundswell support would get created because people saw it. I mean, there are shows like Love is Blind on Netflix, right, that no one had any idea about, right? And then it popped up, we fell in love with it, especially during a time when we were all inside the house, and suddenly each one of the people on the show has millions of followers and everybody knows it. And it would seem to me that a film like this has the same access to people. So to your point, it's not a coincidence or an accident. People already know who Russell Simmons is. People already know about these stories to some extent. And now for a whole film to flesh it out, as we saw with the Michael Jackson stuff, right? And with R. Kelly, and with all, and you would think that that would be enough for people to say, okay, how can I hit the ground running? But again, to your point, I haven't aggressively hit the ground running. I don't know if the Russell Simmons thing is different. I don't think that it's different for me in any way than Bill Cosby was or R. Kelly or other things that I have been proactive about. I don't know what it is. But the fact that it's laying there and not being engaged and not being led by by people who know better, says something, you know, about us. So I guess the question for me is, what can we do? Specifically, what can Black men do? And also there's the media question, right? What can those of us with platforms do to support your work, to be anti-rape culture, to be anti-rape actively, and to advance all of us?
Mm-hmm. So let's address the media first. Let's hold media companies accountable. Mm. They are responsible for the elevation of our stories, but also for the erasure. They perpetuate rape culture myths, and they also can inform. And media, personally, one thing that media really needs to do is to be trauma-informed when they're addressing issues around sexual violence, and be mindful not to subsume a woman who has accused a man of sexual violence under the moniker of so-and-so rape accuser. Mm. Because that centers him and makes her life and her experience and her identity tangential. And that's a form of violence. That is a form of psychic violence, and it's a realignment of a survivor's identity that we don't want. I've lived on this earth for almost 50 years. I have done a whole hell of a lot more than survive being raped by Russell Simmons. Mm. So I don't want that to be my epitaph.
Wow. Wow.
So the media absolutely needs to pay attention and realize, if you think you're gonna keep sliding dude on and there's not going to be a backlash, look at what's happened over the last 2 weeks. There will be a backlash. There will be a backlash.
Right.
And as far as men themselves, to your point, it's not enough to not rape. One must be anti-rape. One must be anti-misogynoir. One must be willing to speak up and be uncomfortable in the presence of their peers, and be willing to have hard conversations, and beyond the conversations, be willing to cut a relationship off with somebody who continues to engage in violence against women and or is not involved in any type of restorative process to address the harm that he has done in the past. Mm. I'm sorry, your golf foursome is not more important than the lives of your sisters.
Yeah.
It is uncomfortable to take a stance against something that is so embedded in our culture, but it is incumbent upon Black men to speak to each other and hold each other accountable, because part of the reason why rape is so pervasive is because men keep giving each other the pass, and men are the ones that sit above Black women. So you all need to take your privilege and use it to hold each other accountable. Black women been in the fight. If we could convince y'all to do what's right, to not objectify us, to not rape us, to not beat us, it would have been done. But we can't do that. So that's on you all.
Yeah.
And the third thing, I mean, it's self-serving, but I will say, check out On the Record. On the Record is a film that does explore the complexity of navigating an industry like hip hop, and why so many women wait decades to come forward. If anything, if you're not into hip hop, if the film isn't your cup of tea, I think that it gives anyone who wants to learn more about how someone like a Russell could operate with impunity for decades and why it would take women decades to come forward. At least right. They answer that question and then have an informed discussion. If at that point you want to say, well, okay, I still don't believe you. I mean, I don't know what else I can say. I know what happened. I have the hospitalization receipts. That's me. But because I do think it's important. If you can believe that a man with such profound entitlement who actually went on the Breakfast Club and essentially admitted that he assaulted Jenny Lamette in his comments, if you can realize that a man with that kind of privilege is unwilling to be held accountable in spite of all these allegations, think about the men that you do know who also are saying that they didn't do it. And then you get to understand that it goes beyond just the power and privilege that Russell has and his wealth. What we're talking about is really the way in which Black people have chosen unequivocally to place our race before anything else.
Well, thank you. Thank you for talking to me. Thank you for thinking this stuff through with me, these ideas, these arguments. I'm grateful. And, you know, I've talked to you off the record, but on the record, no pun intended. You know, I also, you know, want to make sure that I'm using my platforms and my space as much as possible to not just talk about the film, which I think is important to talk about, but to talk about the deeper issues. I've tried to do that, but there's way more to be done. Mm-hmm. There's ways that I could be more intentional and more deliberate, even down to not being on a panel with all cisgendered heterosexual men, which creates the context for the type of stuff that actually happened, right? It sets the table for that. It doesn't have to happen, but it's part of the same toxic sort of ideology. So there's certainly internal work for me to do. There's a lot of it. There's a lot of, you know, political work to be done. But I want to make sure that I'm creating space and opening space for everybody. I'll be doing that work, and mm-hmm. you don't owe it to me to give me support or to advice or to. It's not your job to tell me how to navigate the world or to tell any man how to navigate the world, but I am grateful that you were willing to sit down and have, you know, have conversation. And I just thank you.
Thank you.